Hey everyone, and welcome to Grace Online. My name is Chris Pedro, the online campus pastor here at Grace Community Church, and it is a true honor to be one of the first individuals to welcome you here to our church. Listen, regardless of whether you attend here at one of our two physical campuses, or if you regularly tune in online, we are still one church, and we are so thrilled that we get to grow together as a church family through things like praise and worship, through church community and live interaction, and through powerful teaching and preaching that comes straight from Scripture. So thanks again for joining us this week, and we really are so glad that you're here. And before service starts, you may or may not know this, but when you check into Grace on Facebook or Instagram, your check-in automatically ends up going toward our nonprofit sponsor for the month. And for July, every individual check-in went towards providing 50 gallons of drinking water to people who are in need. And so altogether for the month, we were able to contribute approximately 20,000 gallons last month. That is so awesome. So thank you to everyone for checking into Grace Community Church on social media. And let's keep that going through the month of August as we partner next with Build On to provide a brick to build a school for a community in need. And you can do this right from home or wherever you may be tuning in to our online service. The easiest way to do this on Facebook is by creating a post, hitting the check-in button, and then searching for a location. And you can also use the link in the live chat to go directly to our Facebook page as well. But we really just want to encourage everyone here, because not only do you get to share about your church with others, but we also can literally save lives in such a simple way just by checking in on social media. So thanks for helping us out. But now, as we are just about to get started with service today, I want to encourage and remind you that you are not alone. In fact, Scripture reminds us that we don't have to wrestle or fight through our difficulties on our own, but it's God who is with us and who is fighting for us. And all we are called to do is to stand firm in the Lord. So as we sing about that, let's just fix our eyes on Him and lay everything down at His feet. But listen, from all of us here at our church, thanks for being here and welcome to Grace.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I'm safe with you. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is the cross, God, you see an empty tomb. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through. For us, nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle.
can stand against the power of our God. In an almighty fortress, God, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the fortress, God, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and everything I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh,
says, and we know that God works all things together for those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. Now I know that God always outperforms our deepest feelings that we're feeling. So whether you're feeling despair, let's focus our attention on the victory of Jesus. God, we believe that in this place.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail.
Come on, sing that again. My God will never fail.
No, my God will never fail. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Surrender. We know that you are our conqueror and that you hold victory in your hands.
You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and You turn it for good. You turn it for good. Oh, you take, you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. Yes, you do, Jesus. You turn it for good. You turn it for my good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
I love that passage of scripture that last song comes from, that God in his sovereignty can take what was meant for evil, but then still use it for good. Amen. Well, we are going to continue in worship here in just a moment, but I want to jump in briefly and welcome anyone who is just joining us. My name is Chris Pedro, the online campus pastor here at Grace. And as always, it is so great to have all of you here with us today. And as an extra special shout out, we want to acknowledge and recognize anyone who is here as a new guest. Whether you are checking us out for the first or the second time, or maybe you're just tuning in, but you just haven't made Grace your home church quite yet. Either way, we are so glad that you're here with us online, and we would love to connect with you. In fact, you can help us to do that in a few different ways. The first way is by going to our website, gracesarasota.com, and clicking the I'm New Here button right on the homepage. And then the other way is by texting the phrase new guest SRQ to the number 97000. Doing either of those two things will allow you to fill out our digital connect card, so that way we can just get to know a little bit about you, so we can connect with you, we can be praying for you, and then we'll even send you a free gift as well. Plus, if you'd like, you can also plan a future visit to either of our two campuses here in Sarasota, because we really would love to meet you face to face. So please do check those things out. But if you don't hear anything else, just know that we are so glad that you're here with us today. So welcome. Now, whether you're new or not, we say this almost every weekend, but our church's mission statement is to reach the unchurched by being intentional neighbors who reflect Christ. And so as we take this next moment to receive and ask God to bless this week's offering, I want to personally thank you. Many of you know that we've recently put our Big Splash Summer Festival on at our Bee Ridge campus. We had another baptism celebration, and our kids ministry hosted our two-day VBS, and it was so awesome. And so all these things, we're able to see people come to Christ and to see real life change, and all the glory goes to Him first. But it wouldn't be able to, it wouldn't be possible if it wasn't for your giving and for your generosity. So we just want to say thank you to everybody for trusting the Lord with your finances and for allowing God to continue to have kingdom impact through this church. And if you would like to give, or if this ministry has impacted you in any way, or maybe you just want to be a part of what God is doing here, well, we want to give you an opportunity to give as well. If you can't tell, we want to be a church that is contagiously outrageous in all we do, meaning that we want to be extreme in our love and our generosity, just as God has been toward us. So I want to invite you to trust in Him, watch God move in your life, and then see Him use your gift to reach others. And there are so many different ways that you can do that here at Grace. So just take a look at the bottom of the screen. But let's just take a moment to pause together and to ask God to bless this week's offering. God, we love you. We thank you so much for the truths that we just sang. And God, it's because of those truths that we don't just worship you with our words, but God, we worship you in our giving. God, take all of us, take every single thing that we have to offer, use it for your kingdom and multiply it so that others might come to you. God, we love you, we praise you, and we give you this time. And everybody said, amen. Hey, if you would you continue to sing and worship as we join with the Grace Worship Team?
Church, as we continue to worship, let's just be reminded that the presence of the Lord is here in this place. He's right here to meet you right where you are.
Can't go back to the beginning. Can't control what tomorrow will bring. But I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be. I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again?
And as I walk,
as I walk now through the valley, let your love rise above every fear. Like the sun shaping the shadows, in my weakness your glory appears.
You're in this place, Lord.
I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. All I want
Let your soul sing out, cause all I want
is all you are. Will you meet me here again?
God, right here, right now, we know that your presence is among us. We know that you're in this place and you have come to meet us right where we are, to remind us that you are greater than our insecurity, greater than our doubt, greater than what happened yesterday or the week before. God, you give us the freedom to worship in this place because your presence is among us. And when your presence is here, we can find freedom. And so, Lord, I just pray, Lord, that we can be reminded that as we're in this place and we find your presence in this place, that we make ourselves available to not miss the moment and to not miss the worship that we were created to do right here and right now. We make ourselves available, Lord.
You. sacrifice. Use me how you want to, God. Have your throne within my heart.
Sing, I hear.
Encouraging to know we don't have to live life alone. We have the ultimate leader that we can lean into, and he's available to us, and his name is Jesus. And he's always there. And the more we surrender and the more we lean into him, the more he will show us the path for our life. Let's pray. Father God, you're amazing. And we are so thankful for the love and the care that you pour out to us all day, every day, in so many ways. And God, we just want you to continually show us how to make you the Lord of our lives all day, in our words and in our actions. And God, for anyone in this room who came in with something they need to surrender, a burden they're carrying, or something they're holding on to that they know they need to let go of, but it's just so hard. God, I pray that while they're here in your presence, they find joy, they find peace, and we're able to have a decision. We're able to have a direction. We're able to move forward and surrender all we need to surrender to you, because you are the Lord of our lives. God, you're our joy. You're our peace. You're our King of Kings and you're Lord of Lords. And we know the victory will be ours, not because of our circumstances, but because you defeated evil before we ever set foot on this earth, God. Lord, we love you and we praise you, and we are just so thankful that we have you in our lives. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys can have a seat. You know, it is August and it is time to go back to school. And Pastor Chip really wanted someone to come in and share with us, someone who really understands the next generation. who can teach us about them. They're all around us and amongst us. I'm sure some of you are parents or grandparents. And so it's a real pleasure to introduce Dr. Jeff Baxter to you today. He's an author, a speaker, he's a pastor, he's an actual tour guide to Israel sometimes. He and his wife, Lori, have been married for 27 years and they have three older children. He is the current next-gen pastor at Mars Hill Church in Colorado. And so, Grace, will you please help me give a very warm Grace welcome to Dr. Jeff Baxter.
Well, it is so good to be with you. And I do have a kindred spirit with Pastor Chip. Although we haven't spent a ton of time together, we've spent enough time together to know that he's passionate about the next generation. I'm passionate about the next generation. I know your church is because you have this whole movement that's beginning because of your church. So Pastor Chip and team, thanks so much for letting me be here and to be on the stage and do a little bit of teaching this weekend that we're going to barely scratch the surface. I mean, I've only been given a little bit of time, and we don't have nearly enough time to go into the depth of what we're going to do. But I'm gonna prick and I'm gonna prod, and I know I might even make you mad. Isn't that going to be fun? And you're going to be able to interact a little bit too. So on August 6th, my wife and I celebrated a wedding anniversary, and we've been married 27 years. Thank you. Now, I know some of you are doing the math in your head right now. You're trying to figure out how old I am. Let me help you out. We were married when we were 10, and so it all works out that way. Not really, but not even close. But so here we are. We have a long way to go. So if you have a Bible, flip over to Mark chapter 10, if you would. Mark chapter 10 is where we're going to head today. So everything in the Bible is super important. Everything in the Bible is super important. But how do you know when it's really, really, really important? It doesn't have, you know, there's some things in the Bible that get a little more oomph, a little more emphasis. And here's a clue for you. It's when it's repeated. When a word, when a phrase, when a story in the Bible is repeated, you know that God may want us to get that one. He may want us to, you know, drill down and catch that because, well, three out of the four gospel writers told the story that we're gonna talk about tonight. And Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they share this story, and they all have their own different eyewitness account of this story, but we're going to look at Mark's version or his account of the story tonight, and we're going to look at it, and you're going to understand why very quickly. Now, some of you might be familiar with this story, but I want to give you some details around this that might be helpful for us to take a look at. Take a look at this with me. People were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them. But the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said to them, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." And he took the children in his arms, put his hands on them, and he blessed them. There is so much happening right here because you have to put yourself in their sandals for just a moment. Put yourself into the story. The story probably took place in the middle to the end of Jesus' ministry, which makes all the difference in the world to me and to you. And so here's what's taking place is Jesus is doing his ministry. He's going through things. He loves touching people. As a matter of fact, if you whittle everything down in Jesus' ministry, it's all about touching. It's all about touching people. He loves touching blind people so they get healed. He loves touching the paralytic so they get healed. He loves touching, well, the downcast and the outcast. He loves coming alongside people and touching them, spiritually speaking, but also physically. Jesus is about touching people, and he's about touching the next generation. And you would think by now the disciples would get this, but they don't. So the paparazzi police force, the disciples, they set up the red ropes around Jesus like he's a celebrity. And parents are bringing their children, the next generation, to Jesus. And the disciples, you would think, would be like, "Come on, everybody, come on." And that's not what they do. They repel them. They get in the way. They become a roadblock to having these children, the next generation, come to Jesus. Can you imagine? Can you imagine being them? So what does Jesus do? He gets He's indignant. He rebukes them. He gets angry. He's disgusted. He can't believe that they would do that. And if you look at the original language around those words, it's like he's saying, don't ever do that again. Don't ever stop the children and their parents and the family members from coming to me. Don't do that. Don't ever do that. He gets angry at them. He leans in a little bit further with them, and it's not where he stops. He says, as a matter of fact, unless you're like one of these little children in their faith, you can't enter the kingdom of God. Unless you're like one of them, you can't even enter into this whole thing, this whole kingdom-minded thing, this whole follow the king wherever he goes, the king rules and reigns. You can't get in on that unless you let them come to me. Now catch this. You ready to have your mind blown? This was customary for families to bring their children to rabbis during the day. There'll be a normal thing to do, to bring your child to a rabbi who's well-known in the community and have them take the child in their arms and bless them and speak words of affirmation, encouragement, and blessing over the child. That was normal. What wasn't normal is for God to do it. Jesus is 100% God, right? So isn't it incredible? Watch your mind get blown. Isn't it incredible that God would pick up children and bless them? What was that blessing like? What in the world? And the disciples are preventing that from taking place. So I have a really tough question, maybe a difficult question for us to wrestle with to this weekend. Is it possible we are preventing the next generation from coming and growing closer to Jesus? Is it possible? Now, so for some of you, your quick answer, your quick thought is, no. That's not our church. You're at the wrong place. That's not our church. That's not me. That's not my family. We want the next generation to come to know Jesus and grow closer to him. But I want to lean in a little bit more and give you some categories, because I think the answer overall across capital C church is a strong yes. We are either directly or indirectly, because we don't have enough information to know that we are actually hindering the next generation from coming to know Jesus just like the disciples did. And so I want to give you some categories really quickly for us to think about this weekend. I need to fly through these, but I'm going to get to some answers, so hang with me, okay? Here's some hindering areas of hindering the next generation. Number one, generational differences are dividing us. I don't know if you've noticed or not, but some of you might say, well, that's always been there. There's always been differences in generations. That's true. But think about this. Once upon a time, there was a number of youth who were making a ruckus in a hallway, and then they made their way into the worship center, and during the sermon, they made a real big ruckus, and some older adults got mad about that. And so after church, they immediately called a committee meeting. Anybody know about a committee meeting? Anybody? And they bring the pastor in for this impromptu committee meeting, and they say, we have to do something about those youth who are, I can't even listen to the sermon because they're being just so distracting. And they came up with an idea. They said, hey, anybody want to volunteer to, well, take that over? And a couple parents said, sure, we'll do that. And the pastor said, awesome, we've got a room down the end of the hallway. They can have it. They can paint it. They can put couches in there. It's going to be awesome. And they won't be a distraction down there. And hence, youth ministry was born, everybody. I'm almost exaggerating, but I'm not. Back in the 60s and 70s, this kind of thing happened because people noticed there was a difference between them and us. And what are we going to do about that? We don't want them to be a distraction, so we're going to do something to create some other space for them. And so over the decades, decade after decade after decade, we've separated the generations in general, especially on the weekends, and now we're reaping the negative consequences of these generations being divided. Number two is it's getting longer to grow up. Have you noticed? Now, our immediate response as older adults is, I know. If they were just as responsible as I was when I was a kid, and we do this thing, right? But the reality is that the pressure on them is up. But here's the reality is this word adolescence came into being a number of years ago. And it comes from a Latin word adolescere, which just literally means to grow up. It's just to grow up. And so it's not a negative word, it's just a neutral word to describe that there's a group of people called adolescents that just need to grow up. And so now we can measure this, and I can't go into all the details, but it's about age 11 through mid-20s is how long it's taking for this whole process to work now. We're no longer in Little House on the Prairie days anymore in the 1800s, where it's like you go overnight, you become an adult. It's not happening like that anymore. And as a result, the older generations don't understand that, so we might be hindering them from coming to know Jesus as a result. Another thing to think about is, see if this pops up for me, but number three is the pressure on kids to grow up faster. The pressure on kids to grow up faster. The anxiety level is off the charts. The stress load is off the charts. And you might say, as older adults, it's always been that way. No, it hasn't. It really hasn't. It hasn't because now kids are measured by two things in general, grades and goals, academic achievement and whether they perform on the athletic field or not. And that's how they're measured and that's where their identity is coming from. It is destroying them, everybody. It's destroying them. So whose fault is that? Oh, you're not going to like me. It's parents, coaches, and teachers' fault. That's who it is. We're putting this pressure on them to get the right grades so they can get the right scholarships because we think college is the end goal when college is not the end goal. Maturity in Jesus is. And so as a result, I'm glad some people's not mad at me. Okay, so or we put pressure on that if they didn't score a goal or a basket, then they may not get that scholarship, but I better toss them into that sport as early as possible to make it until they burn out when they're in middle school before they even get even close to that. So we put this pressure on, this anxiety. Another thing that's happening is friendships are changing. The next generation friendships are changing. You remember the movie Grease? The movie Grease portrayed Sandy and Danny are falling in love over the summer. Sandy comes, I'm gonna ruin the movie for you. She comes to school and this whole thing happens. And Danny is part of the leather jacket guys and there's the pink ladies and everyone's well-defined. All those people are the band and athletes and everyone's well-defined and they're kind of in cliques. And if you grew up in the 70s and 80s and went to school during that time like I did, you would totally get it. This makes total sense. It's all changed today. We've moved from cliques to clusters now. Clusters are, we're moving from the movie Grease over to a new movie called Hunger Games. And now it's all about survival, literally. Listen to me, put yourselves in their shoes for a second, the next generation. All they wanna do is survive and get through this thing called life. And so they're gonna surround themselves with the right people that have their backs. It's kind of gang-like, it's kind of family-like. Where now my friends are a band member, an athlete, that person over there, and the only common denominator is we're gonna make alliances so we can get through this game, so we can survive. So that's changing. Also, the family system's totally broken. There used to be a day when we'd say, man, it's kind of falling apart, you guys. Oh man, it's just broken, it's devastated, it's smashed. The definition of family is changing right before eyes in culture. I mean, parents hardly even get along with one another, let alone help their kids grow in Jesus. And siblings, they I don't even know if they like each other very much. And the Bible and prayer is missing. And so we wonder why this whole thing is breaking down or students are having digital overload. Family system's broken, number five. Number six, students are having digital overload. I mean, before the pandemic, they were going through this Zoom thing and now they have Zoom fatigue, but now we know that screen time is off the charts and there's nothing wrong with a cell phone and to be able to get on the World Wide Web and all that, but it's in overdrive right now, so it's really hindering the next generation, I believe, as a result of all that. And so now their identity is measured by the number of TikTok videos they watch or the number of Instagram likes. And it's devastating some things. Number seven, the next generation is biblically illiterate. They're biblically illiterate. I don't need to tell you this, but they don't know who Moses is or David or Solomon or Peter, Paul, and Mary. They don't know that. Some of you do. They don't know that. Or Jesus. They don't know who the biblical Jesus is. They know who homeboy Jesus is and pop culture Jesus, but they don't know the biblical Jesus. And it's devastating. We've got to do something about that. Finally, number eight is moral failure is habitual. The normal thing to do on the weekends these days with the next generation is Netflix and chill. If you don't know what that is, ask somebody in the next generation. They'll tell you. Because moral failure is devastating. They have no moral compass to know how to guide them. And who's going to give that to them? And so, by the way, whose fault is all of this? It's our fault as older adults coming alongside the next generation. It's our fault. We need to own it because we've set up these systems where we've caused this to take place without boundaries, margins, with biblical love, which is grace plus truth equals biblical love. And so we've set this thing up so we're having a hard time knowing what to do today. My wife and I took a plane from Denver to Tampa to get here this weekend. And let me just walk you through the flight experience really fast. I mean, you know it so well. I mean, you buy your ticket, you head to the airport, you go to the certain boarding area where your plane's gonna take off. You sit there, you wait for the order to be called. I don't know how that pecking order goes. Favoritism, I don't know. But you end up walking down the tunnel, going onto the plane, keeping your head down so you don't have to talk to the person next to you. You sit down together and to get to your destination. Now let me talk about church. See, there's a lot of association when you're riding on a plane together, but there's no participation. So you come to church, the same kind of thing happens because the most godly come to this service, right? And so you come and you probably sit in about the same area. You might recognize some people around you. Maybe you know their names, but you probably don't know their stories well. And now let me lean in with the next generation. If you see somebody of the next generation sitting around you, you probably definitely don't know them. You don't know their stories. You don't even ask them any questions or taking them out for coffee or wherever they want to go. By the way, that's the key. Go where they want to go, not where you want to go. You've never been on their turf. So there's a lot of association, but not a lot of participation. And that's what's missing in general with the next generation, with older adults. There's association with them, but not participation. Not deep down, I want to know your name, your story. I want to pour my life into you. I want to hear what's going on. We don't do that very well. So let me give you really quickly a few answers that we can lean into, okay? You with me on this? Let me give you some answers. Number one, pass them passion. Listen, the next generation is so sick and tired of rote, lukewarm, going through the motions Christianity, which, by the way, is no Christianity at all. So what do we have to do these days? We have to add an adjective on the front end of follower of Jesus or Christian. Oh, they're a radical Christian. Oh, they're an on fire Christian. Like what? Like there's degrees of Christianity? What in the world? The next generation is watching us to see if this thing really works or not. And it all boils down to one event, everybody. It boils down to the resurrection of Jesus. If Jesus rose from the grave, then we need to live that in with passion. Because if he didn't rise from the grave, let's all go pack up and go home. Why do we even sing those songs? But if he did rise from the grave, the next generation's watching to see if this passion thing, if this Jesus thing works at the gas station, works at the grocery store, works at the beach, works over there, works. They want to know if this thing's for real, and they're watching us, the older generation, to see if it's true or not. If Jesus rose from the grave, it makes all the sense in the world. Listen, you can't teach passion. It's just caught. You catch passion. You can catch it in your daily time alone with the Lord every day. You can catch it from other people that are around you who just are, man, we have to describe it. Like they're on fire for Jesus. Like we don't just say they're a follower of Jesus. Like it's normal they would be on fire for Jesus. We have to add adjectives, but you can catch it. Let me illustrate it this way. Do you guys remember what the sermon was here on this weekend 4 weeks ago? Maybe not. Do you remember last week? Maybe. Do you remember how passionate Pastor Chip is about reaching the next generation? Of course you do. Why? Because more is caught than taught. It just is. You can show it. So some of us need to tell our faces that sometimes. Like that Jesus really rose from the grave. I'm preaching to myself. I mean, that Jesus really did raise from the grave, and the next generation wants to know if that's true. Number two is grow them with grace. Listen, we spend a whole lot of time on doctrine and theology, and I know this church does, and that's a beautiful thing. And we want to figure out the rules and the regulations and the laws, and there's a lot of them in the Bible. You got to discern through and figure out what's applicable today and what's not. You got to work through all that stuff. But at the end of the day, grace brings them home. Grace brings them home. And some homes don't feel that way. I had to work on this one in my own life. Because I like to control stuff. But control is based on rules and regulations, not grace. And so Jesus said it best, by this all people will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. That's it. That's how they're gonna know. Whether you're extending love and grace, what that looks like. I realize those two words are different, but they're so closely connected that they're almost one and the same. Another area we need to do is hold them with holiness. Hold them with holiness. As soon as you thought, oh, you know, it's all about grace, 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 like there's permission to do whatever you want to do. Oh, no, 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 no. We need to hold them with holiness. Peter said it best, for this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Whoa, what a mouthful. Did you notice the promise? The promise is if you do these things, if you grow in holiness, then you're gonna be productive and fruitful. But the opposite's true too. If you don't grow in these areas, you're not gonna be effective and fruitful. Listen, we need to stop doing all of the cultural research to figure out what the next cool thing is for the next generation. I've fallen into that trap in years past where I thought, well, if I could just know what are they gonna wear? I'm not gonna squeeze in the skinny jeans. Nope, not gonna do that. I mean, is it fog machines? Is it the best PowerPoint presentation? What's the cutting edge thing that's gonna be? I mean, here's the reality, you guys. The next generation has left Facebook. Why? Because their parents are on it. And as soon as they figure out that all the parents are on Instagram now, they're gone. And now they know. There's gonna be another app in town that they go to because they want their own space. They don't want older adults harping over them, telling them what to do and all this stuff and evaluating what all this stuff. They don't want that. They want their own space there. We've got to show them what holiness is all about. Listen, if we went to a community pool together and we went into the community pool to go swimming and we came in the gate and we saw over in the kiddie pool area that has a different fence with a small pool over there, if we saw an older grown man sitting in the kiddie pool, splashing around all by themselves, we would think that's not only weird, that's wrong. He should be over in the deep end of the pool, swimming around doing that with the other adults, shouldn't he? It'd be weird for him to be by himself over there with the children doing that. But I get confused when somebody has known Jesus for decades, and they ought to have this passion for Jesus that's off the charts, and they ought to be more mature than everybody else in the room, and they ought to have this missional mindset where they're pouring their life into the next generation. I get confused because it's almost like they're sitting in the kiddie pool when they should be taking the next generation over the deep end of the pool. Are you following me? I'm quite certain there's a ton of you who've known Jesus a long time and you are immersed and love Jesus and you know the word of God. And boy, you are totally equipped to go after the next generation and invest in them and pour into them and love them and grow them in holiness. Which leads me to number four, tell them the truth. There are no substitutes for great biblical teaching. There just aren't. And I've paid attention online and I noticed that grace is that kind of church and Pastor Chip is that kind of pastor. He wants to give you the word of God and give you the truth of the scriptures. And the Bible is unique, there's no doubt about it, but it's also inspired. It's when it's all said and done, it's written by God through man to us. It's his love letter to us. It's his instructional manual put together. It's a compass and a map to guide us. It's a boat rudder to get us through terrible storms. It's a rock that's immovable. It's food for our souls. Without it, listen, you will die. Without the word of God, you'll die. Did you know that? You are saved by the word of God. And you're going to grow through the word of God. And the next generation desperately needs you to come alongside them to give them the truth. Earlier this summer, I was teaching in a middle school camp, and we're going through the life of Joseph from the Old Testament in the book of Genesis. And as we're going through several chapters this whole week. And so we had a morning session, evening session, and I'm sharing this thing. And I get to the end of one of the sessions, and I say, it's kind of to be continued. We're going to find out what happens in Joseph's life next time. And you literally heard middle schoolers say, No, what happens? What happens? And inside of me, I got to admit it, I was a little bit happy about that because I'm like, they're tracking with me. This is good. They're tracking with me. They want to come back. They want to hear more. They don't want to leave the camp. It's awesome. The other half of me went, oh no, they don't have a clue. They don't have any idea what happens with Joseph's life or his brothers, his dad, or the nation of Israel. They have no idea what's going to take. They literally don't. They've never heard the story before. And I went, oh, what have we done? Why aren't we sharing the truth of all the biblical stories in the context of a redemptive plan for all of history that would culminate in Jesus? Why aren't we sharing that with the next generation? And what are we missing here? And that gets awfully scary to think about. Number five, amaze them with God. When it all boils down to it, this is all we have. This is all we have. I love this psalm. Even when I'm old and gray, and you guys, I'm getting gray. Do not forsake me. Oops, skipped ahead. Do not forsake me, my God, till I declare your power to the next generation, your mighty acts to all who are to come. Your righteous God reaches to the heavens. You have done great things. Who is like you, God? All we have to share is the power and the faithfulness of God and what he's done in history, which is what the Israelites did back in the Old Testament. They kept telling the stories of how faithful God was. They set up standing stones to show how faithful God was. Into the future, it's the same thing that was taking place when the church launched, only they had one story. Jesus is alive. I've seen him. He's alive. He rose from the grave. It was a pretty boring sermon, you guys. If you go read the sermons of the New Testament, it's one thing. Jesus is alive. And they're like, what? He is? Let's go. And they're on mission for him. We need to do the same thing. We need to share how God has been faithful in your life, in your family, with your friends. You need to tell that story. You need to keep track of that. You need to journal that. You need to come up with a box that you put things into that you can look back on later on of how faithful God has been. You need to be able to tell those stories, because if you don't, how is the next generation going to fall in love with God and his faithfulness and what he's been up to? All we have is being amazed by God. Listen, imagine you had a dream and you... In this dream, there's a chair, and around the chair are a number of people and a number of crazy-looking creatures and the most pristine glass you've ever seen in all of your life. There's a rainbow coming from this chair. There's like lightning bolts and thunder coming from it, and in your dream, you get a little startled by that. And all of this is this culmination of the person who's sitting on the chair or throne, and his name's Jesus. And this is what John would write down in Revelation chapter 4 as a picture of how awesome, glorious, amazing this Jesus is that we worship. And that's when it all boils down to it, that's all we've got. That's all we've got to pass on to the next generation, is we need to have this awe of God so we pass on this power of amazement towards him. Let me just give you a few questions for you to think about as we get towards the end here. I know you just drank out of a fire hydrant, of information, but I'll bet there's some things that you might want to think about. Are you growing in your passion for Jesus? Is it attractive? Is it magnetic, especially to the next generation? Or do you need to reevaluate that and think through, man, where's my passion level for Jesus? Because you can't contain that. Remember, more is caught than taught. And where do you go first? Well, go to your individual time with the Lord. Go to the Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Gospels. Go spend some time with Jesus and ask him to let your passion level rise. Number two is, are you characterized by grace-giving or rule-keeping? It's so easy to go to the rule-keeping side, but with the next generation, we've got to lean towards grace because this is a marathon, not a sprint. This is not 1 year. This is multiple years these days. Number three, is your life marked by being holy for God, being set apart for him? Is there any area of your life, and I'm speaking to myself now, any area of your life whatsoever that's getting between you and your fellowship with the Lord? Anything at all, any habits you formed, any sin you've let creep in, anything at all, anything that would cause the next generation to say, they're such a hypocrite, because they are turned off faster than you can imagine by that word. And on one level, we're all hypocrites. That's why we need Jesus. But on the other level, we ought to be pursuing holiness so we eliminate those things from our life. Number four, do you know the Bible? Are you passing the Bible on to others? I know this is the kind of church where you get a lot of great Bible teaching and training and all sorts of places for you to grow in your biblical knowledge so that you can pass it on to the next generation. Number five, are you giving them the power of God? Are you sharing the stories of his faithfulness? Do you have a list? Maybe you need to spend some time this weekend jotting down a list of where God's been faithful in your life. It doesn't have to be these off the chart things, but there are areas every single one of us can have a list of, man, I didn't have any idea what he was up to there, but as I look back on my life, man, he was so faithful. And then turn around and share that story with somebody in the next generation, because that's what we need to pass on to them. Let me conclude this way. My wife and family and I love to go to the Denver Zoo. We haven't been in a long time, but we love to go there and see the animals. And right when you go in the beginning of the exhibit, the lions are right there. And if you're lucky, you get to hear the lions sitting on a rock roaring. You don't see that every day. And it echoes through the whole zoo. But you knew that groups of animals have names, right? So let me test your knowledge really fast. A group of lions is called a pride. Yeah, a group of cows is called a herd. Yeah, group of elephants. Anybody know that? It's called a parade. True story. Three elephants walking by. That's a parade right there. Group of crows. That's a murder. Yeah, because they leave a scene and it looks like a murder scene because it's a group of crows called a murder. Group of baboons. That's called Congress, everybody. It's called Congress. It's not a political joke. I'm just saying that's literally what it... No. Now I'm in trouble. Okay. Group of flamingos, kind of fun. Flamboyance is what a group of flamingos is. And here's my favorite, a group of rhinos. Rhinoceri. Group of rhinos. You know what they're called? Well, a lot of weight going at 15 miles an hour. They can only see about 15 feet in front of them. A group of them going that direction is called a crash. Because that's what's going to happen. I think what we need to do with the next generation is we need to have a rhino mindset. Like, it does not matter what gets in our way. We need to pursue Jesus with everything we have in Jesus' name. And we might knock over some things along the way, but it's for the sake of those, not who are coming behind us, but those who are with us now. That's what we need to do. We need to get after it like rhinos. It doesn't matter if we crash into some things, if it's biblical, if it's for the glory of God, if it's for Jesus. And if we don't do that, friends, here's the tragedy. We're in big, big trouble. We're already behind the curve. We've got to catch up fast. Let's pray together. Let's pray together. Father, we are seems a little overwhelming to me when I sit where I am and the position I'm in and the opportunities that I have. It's sort of like world evangelization. Like, how? What part do I play? How in the world could we reach the whole world for Jesus? It feels like that a little bit. Like, how do we reach the next generation? What's my part? And I really think if we whittle it down to these five areas, we start doing some introspection in our own hearts, that we could change the world. You could start with grace. You could start with this church right here. They're already well on their way, Lord. And I know what you've put inside Pastor Chip and the team is, Lord, would you set them loose? Would you have others join in who've been on a little bit on the outskirts, but now they get it. Maybe through the power of the Holy Spirit today, you've prompted them to say, man, I want to get in the game. What do I do? That would be a good first step. But Lord, we have to have our passion for you grow. We have to grow in grace. We have to hang on to holiness. We have to keep teaching the truth. We have to keep doing these things with authenticity so the next generation can see that this thing called Christianity is real. Lord, I'm tired of seeing so many of the next generation turn their backs on Jesus and leaving the faith altogether. And it's because they didn't have good experiences with older adults. So please turn the tide on that. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you would, stand and worship with us one last time.
Ah.
generations, your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, your families, your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you.
Church, we're coming now to the end of today's service, but before we go, please know that we are here for you as a church family. If something from service today has spoken to you, or if you would like to pray with someone on our care team, or if you just would like to let us know how this ministry has impacted you, then make sure that you don't leave here today without contacting us. Either send us an email at grace@gracesarasota.com or simply call the number on the screen or in the chat. And to all of our new guests, don't forget that we would love to connect with you as well. Remember to go to the homepage of our website, gracesarasota.com, and click the I'm New Here button, or use your phone to text New Guest SRQ to 97000. Either way, you'll be able to fill out our digital connect card and receive a free gift from our church, and you'll also be able to plan a future visit to either our Lakewood Ranch or our Bee Ridge campuses. But all that being said, it is time for us to go out and reach the unchurched by being intentional neighbors. Church family, we love you and we can't wait to see you again real soon, and don't forget to bring a friend. And as always, thanks so much for joining us here at Grace, where everyone is welcome.